Nancy.
Go ahead.
Hello. I'd like to welcome everybody. It is Tuesday, May 19th, 2020. We are having a meeting on the Water and Sewer Department's FY21 budget. As we get rolling into this, I think everyone's getting this down by now. Per New Hampshire, RSA 91-A:2,3, the chair has declared COVID-19 outbreak an emergency and has waived the requirement that a quorum be physically present at the meeting, pursuant to the governor's executive order 2020-04, section 8, and executive order number 12, section 3. Members will be participating remotely and will identify their locations, and any person present with them at that location. All votes will be by roll call. So I am Rick Beckstead. I am at my home at 1395 Islington Street. My family is in the other end of the house watching TV.
I'm Jim Spillane at 201 Oriental Gardens. And alone, other than my cat who's sitting next to me, he might make an appearance later when he decides to crawl on me.
Dago McCachran, 230 Thornton Street, by myself at the moment in my house.
Peter Whalen, 100 Gate Street, upstairs in my office, and my wife Karen is downstairs having dinner.
Cliff Lazenby, 303 McKinley Road, in the basement. My daughter's down here doing a Zoom ballet call, which is going to be very different than our call. The rest of the family's somewhere else in the house.
Astor Kennedy, 41 Pickering Ave. If you hear loud noise, there are people at my yard trying to move kayaks.
Petrahuda, 280 South Street. I'm here. Family is somewhere around, and they're quiet, so I'm happy.
John Tabor, 55 Pleasant Point Drive. I'm in my back office. My wife, Betsy, is out front.
Paige Trace, excuse me. Paige Trace, 27 Hancock Street. I'm here alone with Teddy, who's somewhere in the book room, to prevent him from barking out by the front window in the kitchen.
We still have staff that's on here to be able to basically do the same.
Sure. Good evening. I'm Karen Connard, City Manager. I'm at my home in Salem, New Hampshire with my family.
I'm Kelly Barnaby, City Clerk. I'm here at my home in Sanford, and my husband and dogs are downstairs.
Peter Rice, Director of Public Works, at my office over on Beverly Hill Road. Brian Getz is in the office next to me, and I think Nick, the custodial guy, is downstairs.
Brian Getz. Yes, as Peter said, I am in the office next door to him here at 680 Beverly Hill Road, DPW. Unmute, Terry.
Terry Damaris. I'm in Elliott, Maine, in my home, and family is about in the house.
Suzanne Woodland, Deputy City Attorney in Stratham. Family's downstairs.
Judy Belanger, Finance Director. I'm at City Hall with the Deputy Finance Director, Andrew Pargo, and the Controller, Judy Renau.
All right. So I skipped a step, Kelly. I'm hoping that roll call would be sufficient. I didn't say roll call when you called the name, so.
That's okay. I can record it as the roll call. You all said you were there and your address.
Perfect. All right. Expedience here. So with that being said, I'm going to turn it over to City Manager Karen Connard.
Good evening. Well, I don't see anyone at present who may wish to speak. I will read the announcements, Mr. Mayor. This meeting is being live broadcast on the city's YouTube channel and channel 22, as well as over Zoom. You do not need to log into the Zoom broadcast unless you are presenting at the meeting tonight or have comments for the public hearing. Registration is required to participate in this meeting. Please see the meeting agenda posted on our website for more details. If for any reason you find this meeting is not accessible through the channels listed above, please notify the producer at 603-610-7252. Once we walk through our presentation and the mayor opens up the listening session portion of the meeting, please wait to be called on. To indicate you would like to speak, please virtually raise your hand by clicking on the raise hand icon on your menu at either the bottom or top of your screen. If you've joined by telephone only, please press star 9 to alert the host that you'd like to speak. When the mayor calls on you to speak, the moderator will enable your audio and unmute your microphone. With that, Mr. Mayor, I would like to welcome all the staff that are here tonight, and I would like to reiterate what we've said in previous budget work sessions as an overview, that the water and sewer proposals come in at a zero increase. And with that, I will turn things over to Deputy Director Brian Goetz. He will begin our presentation.
Great.
Unmute, thank you. I believe the screen might be up. Let's share screen. Okay. So I can see Kelly. So are we seeing the screen, Kelly? Yes, thank you. All right, good. Well, thank you, everyone. Thank you, City Manager Kennard and Mayor and City Council. Again, my name is Brian Goetz, Deputy Director of Public Works. With me tonight, we've got Peter Rice, Director of Public Works, Terry Damaris, the City Engineer, David Hyder, the rate consultant that has been working with us for, this is year number 8 now, on our water sewer rate model and rate projections, and rate increase projections is also with us. He's not in the room yet, but will be let in for his portion of the presentation. So with that, I want to just give an overview. Great. So there we go. Thank you. So the introduction. So tonight we would like to give you just some brief overviews and highlights of the water, sewer, and stormwater systems, our budget approach, and the response since the initial budgeting, which began late last year and started early this year, and response recently to COVID-19, and the projected rate increase adjustments, and our proposed fiscal year 21 budget. Before I do that, I want to give a shout out to staff that are continuing to provide the essential services, water, sewer, stormwater. Here's our staff in action doing what they do. And I think in these moments of, the COVID-19, especially, want to think that people should really appreciate the fact that we deliver services and it comes right to your door, right to your tap. So a big thanks to everybody out there that's continuing to do what they do to keep us going 24/7. We'll continue to do so best we can as we hope to get out of COVID-19. So quickly, the Water Division is really comprised of a regional water system. So Portsmouth is a regional water system. We serve the community of communities of Portsmouth. We also serve a good portion of Newington, Greenland, some of Rye, and we also wholesale water to the Rye Water District, and the entire island of Newcastle, which half of the island is city operated by the city of Portsmouth. The other half is the Newcastle owned and operated portion of the island, and they are actually themselves undertaking quite a extensive capital project in the Newcastle water system, replacing their water main all along the causeway there into town from the Pierce Island side and all the way through the center of town. So that'll be ongoing. Another great project for people to look forward to as far as traffic goes and stuff. But on the Portsmouth, the Portsmouth system has the Bellamy Reservoir. We're both a surface and a groundwater system. We have 6 wells that combine with the surface water treatment, and we have 3 water storage tanks and 173 miles of pipeline. We also operate the Pease International Trade Port water system, abbreviated to just Pease Trade Port here for brevity's sake. which consists of three wells. The Haven well, as many know, is currently out of service. The other two wells are treated with activated carbon. There are two water storage tanks there and 17 miles of pipe. Highlights, would like to point out, as we sent to council early in January, we have, and it's also on the website, an 8-page summary of the year in review, which covers runs the gamut of a water supply, water quality, lots of demographics regarding precipitation and how we're doing as far as supply versus demand. Happy to report, as soon we'll go out in our water quality report that's mailed here in early June, that both the Portsmouth and the Pease drinking water systems are in compliance with all drinking water regulatory requirements. And we continue to respond and treat the Pease Trade Port PFAS contamination. We hit a milestone just last week, our sixth year of the Haven well being out of service due to the PFAS contamination. Just a couple really important projects on the quality side. Our Newington booster station was completed. On the right are some new pumps that have provided replaced the original pumps there that were over 50 years old. So the booster system from Madbury into Portsmouth has now new efficient pumps and a much more reliable system. But on the left side, this cutaway view is what was installed inside the Newington booster tank. And that's an aeration system that treats for total trihalomethanes. So we had at times experience trihalomethanes that especially on the extremities of the system in Newcastle that exceeded the standard. With this aeration system, we are seeing numbers lower than we've ever seen, and it's really doing the job. It aerates and treats total trihalomethanes. So we're really happy to have that online, and that came into service late last year. Here's a shot of the Pease well treatment system. Bottom right shows the new carbon filters that are going in there. The building on the right will soon be demolished and added on to put the resin filters in. On water pipeline projects, we had a busy year last year. Islington Street, South Bartlett was worked on. There's continued work at the intersection going on right now. Maplewood and Pleasant Street areas. The Little Harbor School road waterline was replaced, and this shot on the photo on the top right shows you our city crew that did an installation of a waterline in Newington on Coleman Drive. We also happy to announce that a new billing system was brought into service. The real plus side of this, we hope in the future, is to really bring enable customers to be able to get through customer portals to get their own customer data. And we hope to, over time, provide more real-time ability to have customers know water usage, which is good as far as trying to, work on water efficiencies, but also if there's leaks and they could be notified if consumption is over a parameter which might alert them to some type of leak in their system. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Terry, give you an overview of the sewer.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council, and City Manager Kennard. The sewer division also does treatment on a regional basis. We treat the City of Portsmouth, the Pease International Trade Port. We also treat the entire town of Newcastle. We have a couple customers in Greenland and portions of Rye. The treatment occurs through two wastewater treatment facilities. One is the Pearson Wastewater Treatment Facility that's currently in the midst of a large upgrade, and the other is the Pease Treatment Facility, which serves the entire International Trade Port. On the sewer collection and pumping station side, we have a number of assets as well. Those include about 115 miles of sewer main and force main for those pump stations, about 20 wastewater pumping stations, We conduct with this group our DigSafe program, and also we support a portion of the meter backflow program because it's used for our sewer billing. Next slide, please. We have a number of core functions and services for these different groups. So on the wastewater treatment plant side, our first and foremost, we have to meet compliance with specific permit limits put on us by the Environmental Protection Agency. Second to that, we have to maintain and take care of the facilities, everything inside the fence line of the treatment plant. So we refer to this as preventive and corrective maintenance, and it's inclusive of everything: buildings, the grounds, piping underneath the grounds, the treatment equipment. There's a lot of monitors and other miscellaneous equipment that watch everything as it's doing its job. HVAC are things like heating, ventilating, air conditioning, and other electrical equipment. We focus a lot on facility improvements, and this portion of our group is in charge of the industrial user program, which sets limits on industrial users who discharge to the sewer system. You'll see for all of our groups, you're going to see this next item, which is 24-hour operation and oversight, which occurs 365 days a year. Next slide, please. Related to the core functions of the other groups, on our collection system side, they conduct maintenance as well. They're also geared up to do minor construction like replacement of portions of sewer and sewer manholes. We have, they coordinate and review all new installations and connections to the collection system, do annual pipe inspection and cleaning inside the sewer. And this group is responsible for the fats, oil, and grease program, which is closely coordinated with the health department and all of the restaurants. On the pumping station side, the pumping stations are similar to a very small version of a treatment plant. They don't have the treatment components, but they have a lot of the same types of valves, equipment, and facilities. It's just distributed throughout the city because they're at all their individual locations. And again, both of these groups are doing 24-hour operation of these facilities. Next. For the wastewater treatment facilities, and as I mentioned earlier, we do have to comply with regulatory requirements. These are wastewater permits. They're referred to as National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System, or NPDES, we commonly say. So if you hear me fall back into lingo, that's what it means. But essentially, it's a wastewater permit issued by the Environmental Protection Agency, and it sets the limits of effluent limits that we can discharge. Both of our wastewater treatment facilities, Pierce Island facility as well as the Pease facility, have an individual permit. For Pierce Island, that permit was actually set back in 2007, and through the consent decree, we just started actually meeting compliance with that as part of the construction upgrade and the phasing of that work beginning in April of 2020. For Pease, we have a permit that's dated the year 2000. It's pretty common for the EPA to administratively extend permits once they expire. So this one expired in 2005 and we continue to operate under it. However, in June of 2009, after reviewing the needs of users in the Pease area, we determined it was necessary to submit a request for additional capacity at that plant. So that was put in June, and EPA is currently working on a draft permit that would provide for additional flow at that treatment facility. Lastly, we have here a topic of discussion at last night's meeting. I'll be it brief, but the draft Great Bay Toll Nitrogen General Permit. So this permit will set out to set limits on nitrogen effluent from both the Pierce Island and Pease facility. This permit is a general permit across the entire estuary, or a portion of the estuary, all the treatment plants, and regulates 12 of the communities out of the 52. All of those 12 communities have wastewater treatment facilities. So that permit was issued for comments, public comment, as part of the process in January, and as we mentioned last night, we submitted those comments on May 8th, and we suspect it'll be a number of months before this is seen in final. Next, please, Brian. There is as it relates to the regulatory side of the wastewater budget, there are impacts. So when we look at these NPDES or these wastewater permit limits, when we're given a new permit that has lower limits, we have to make changes at the treatment plants. Those changes result in capital expenditures. And a lot of times with those types of capital expenditures, and we'll talk about this more this evening, for Pierce Island, there's also operational expenditures, because the lower that you treat, the more it costs you, whether it's for disposing of sludge or the electricity to actually accomplish the treatment. Another regulatory impact on our budgets is related to what's called our long-term control plan. This is because we have a combined collection system, and that combined collection system has certain outlets called combined sewer overflows, where during wet weather events, if the pipe is overwhelmed, there's a discharge to a water body outside the sewer system of combined sewage. Because we have that combined system, the Clean Water Act requires that we have a long-term control plan to minimize that combined sewer overflow over time. And that has resulted in a significant expenditure of work to separate the drainage and sewer systems. And we estimate that we've spent nearly $60 million on that in the last 20 years. Slide, Brian. And then just related to these major projects, we have here just a summary of the Pierce Island plant. So the Pierce Island facility, while it's still under construction, is operational in treating wastewater. Its total cost was $91.9 million, and that's a significant impact, and you'll see later in our budget presentation what that means for the sewer side of things. Then also the Pease Headworks, we are in the midst of completing a headworks, which you see on the right-hand side here, and that was a $6 million project.
So I'd like to segue into talking about our budget process. So both pre and post COVID-19. So again, as I said, late last year and early this year, we worked with staff under the direction of the city manager and the finance department. I have to give a shout out to their assistants, Judy Blander, Judy Renault, and Andrew Pergel, together with Roberta Orsini here at Public Works, really helping behind the scenes with us. Also Al Pratt and Patrick Wiley, the respective managers of the water and wastewater operations, because we sat down and what we did is, you know, took a line by line item approach, looking at a realistic projections, because as Terry said, we've got a lot of new systems in place, and what are our projections? We somewhat had to judge on based on maybe some short runs of what systems were in operation, but also the projected through engineering estimates of the needs. We also went through other lines to look at things that we could true up and base on realistic projections. But as Terry said, there are new systems in service, especially on the sewer side, that are impacting the budget and the day-to-day increases at the Pease Headworks, new pumps, additional pumping there. So that's additional energies, larger building to heat. And likewise, Pierce Island, with a lot of facilities going from what was just the basic treatment to this advanced nitrogen removal. Again, as we started, we were shooting for increases that were recommended in past model years to project out the needs to, you know, not only meet our needs for financing today, but the future debt service. So the recommended rate model increase noted in the FY20 budget was for water a 2% marginal increase and for sewer a 4%. Have to point out that on the water side, our rates would be much higher if not for the Air Force agreements to fund the PFAS treatment system. So we've been very fortunate with the Air Force. They've been, you know, the responsible party, but also willing after negotiations. A shout out to Suzanne Woodland for all her help with that, because we have a number of agreements, including a most recent one where the Air Force has agreed for the cost differential of the additional operational costs. So we just recently got our first agreement with them on that, but they're also funding all the capital costs. So this is a project that doesn't show up in the city CIP, it doesn't show up in our budget, but you know, is paid for, and you know, we are managing the construction, we're running the system, and fortunately the Air Force is reimbursed us for the cost of that. Just a rough estimate, to cover that cost, we would have needed about a 15% increase in the water rates. So post-COVID-19, so getting a meeting with city manager and finance again, we worked to reduce the water rate increase to both a 0% on water and sewer. And tonight we'll talk about the effects of that and what that means. Certainly for our customers, that means no increase in the water or sewer rate this year for them. But then additionally, we looked at other things as far as just trying to do the best to, you know, hold the line on things. We have three open positions, one each in the water, sewer, and stormwater systems. So at present, we've chosen we're going to hold off on posting and looking to hire. We do hope we want to keep them in the budget, but just not fill them to save that money for now. And as things hopefully recover, we'll in FY22 we would certainly like to fill those positions, because they certainly are needed, and fully staffed we can get a lot of more work done ourselves. And finally, as Dave Heider will talk a little bit about when he gets into the rate projections, that what we're dealing with, there's some, you know, on the expense side of what the increased expense for both the water and sewer systems is really capital intensive. It's very much, you know, essentially our mortgage payments, and those are fixed. Once we, you know, purchase a system, once we build something and we finance it, those costs are not something that changes year to year. So we have to embed those in and do our best to, you know, manage accordingly. But it's really about the future capital projects. So we would look to delay future capital projects if need be. Certainly there is some word on the street from the federal side that there may be infrastructure stimulus monies later, but there is nothing set certain at the present, but we'll be at the ready if that happens. So with that, I just wanted to give you an overview of our approach to the budget, and I'm going to turn it over to David Heider, who's going to go a little bit more into our rate model, and then we'll circle back and Terry and I will go over the budget and then into the stormwater briefly as well.
All right. Thank you, Brian. Well, good evening. My name is Dave Heider. I'm with Stantec, and I'm joining you from Maryland today. So I appreciate the opportunity to speak with you. And as Brian mentioned, we do want to dive a little bit into the rate model, the approach, and talk about really what the impact of not having the adjustments in 21 has. But before we do that, I just want to remind everybody in terms of how the city accounts for the water and sewer operations. So the city accounts for it as enterprise funds. And so as an enterprise fund, the operations of the system are financed and operated in a manner that's similar to a private business. So essentially what that means is that you must have fees and charges that are sufficient to cover the cost of operating the system. And that includes your operating costs, your capital costs, as Brian talked about, the reinvestment in the system and debt service and things of that sort. So you are solely dependent upon the charges that you charge your customers for the use of the service. And so it's important to note that there is no property tax subsidy that's provided to water and sewer funds. They are truly self-supporting. So they're very dependent upon those charges for service. And so as a result, it's very important that we forecast and look at usage and think about the future in terms of what we need to do to make sure that the system is sustainable. And so if Brian goes to the next slide, Brian alluded to this a little bit, but what this slide shows is the cash funding components for the water and the sewer system. So the pies here show the breakdowns of really types of costs. And what you see with the water and sewer system is that they are extremely capital intensive. So cash funded capital on an annual basis, reinvestments in the system, debt service associated with historical investments, generally make up a pretty significant component. So you can see here on water, it's about 40% of your total pie there. On sewer, it's about 41%. And sewer is actually going to grow over the next couple of years as you have to start paying for the debt service associated with the Pease plant. I will say, though, that the, you know, the 40-30-30 split here is fairly typical what we see with communities around the country. So you're not out of line in terms of your spending. And then just the other components would be obviously personnel. That's the staffing, managing the facilities, and then you have your operations and maintenance, which make up the balance, which would include things like chemicals, energy, maintenance on the system, making sure things are operational. So the key point here is, again, it is a heavily capital intensive operation. Regardless of whether people use the service or not, you generally have a significant fixed cost that's associated with it. So with that context, on the next slide, I just wanted to talk about where you've been in terms of the rate setting policy. So as Brian mentioned, we've been walking down this road now for about 8 years. First study started in 2012, where we kicked off the rate study. And then during fiscal year 13 and 14, there were a number of council work sessions. We solicited a lot of public input in terms of getting guidance and what terms of the rate setting approach would be used going forward. And that approach has really guided us over the past 5 years. The rate model that has been developed, it's a financial Excel model that looks out into the future and that we continually roll forward and allows us to forecast what the needs of the system are. And so as part of that process, we've been adjusting rates over the past 5 years. And as Brian mentioned, the plan this year, due to the COVID impacts, would be to hold off and not do a rating adjustment. So on the next slide, it really gives you a sense for the approach that's been used over the past few years. So we've used this terminology in the past. It's a glide path approach to raising rates. And really what that consists of is adjusting rates gradually in anticipation of future expenditures. We've known for a long time that the city has some pretty significant capital investments that are coming down the pipe. And as a result, we wanted to be in a position where we could manage those without some significant rate spikes. So what this slide here shows is two approaches, the first being the stabilized financial plan, which is what the city has used over the past several years, and that's a gradual increase in rates that provides steady and predictable rates within the community. And then the green line essentially shows an approach where you do a break-even increase. So if you waited until your cash requirements reached a certain point and then just increased the rates significantly to meet those requirements. And oftentimes that'll cause some strife within the community if you take that type of approach. And so on the next few slides, we have some examples of how that looks in practice. So what's been done over the past 5 years and what we were forecasting. So there's a lot going on this slide, so take a moment to explain here. But what the bars essentially represent are those cash components, or the cash requirements, and this is just the water system alone. So you can see personal expenses, your other operating cost, any cash funded capital in the green, and then debt service, so your annual debt service payments. And the culmination or the addition of those gives you your total cash requirements in the system. And then what's shown on the orange line is the revenues on the system and how they've trended. So you can see on water from fiscal year 15 to 18, you didn't have any rate increases. Revenue stayed relatively flat. But then you did adjust rates 2% in 19 and again in 20. And then we had forecasted the need for continued increases at about 2%, because you can see the forecasted revenue requirements on the system are continuing to grow. And so the next slide shows reality now. With a 0% increase in fiscal year 21, and then a forecast of what potentially is required in the future. So we have some modest increases above that 2% to potentially get you back on track It is important to note that the city does go through a process on an annual basis to look at the rates, and so these are just forecasts at this point. But given what we know in the expenditures, most likely you would need to do rate increases above the 2% that have been forecasted in the past, given the 0% increase in fiscal year 21. So we have similar slides for sewer on the next slide, and this run really gives a sense for that stabilized glide path approach versus a break even. So same scenario, you can see the addition of the costs in the bars and then what's actually been done. You've been on a path of 4% increases over the past several years. And we had a forecast of continued 4% increases going forward. And you can see the reason for that primarily is because of what's happening in fiscal year 22. And that's when your debt service associated with the Pierce Island plant comes due. So your debt service increases by $5 million in fiscal year 22. And so we've been planning for that for a number of years, building up some net position that's going to allow you to gradually increase rates to get them up to matching your costs on the system. And so the next slide shows where we are today with a 0%. So obviously revenues are flat between 20 and 21. And then again, we're forecasting that in order to keep us on a path where we can not use up all the net position, get revenues in line with expenditures, you would need to do some additional increases above the 4% in the coming fiscal years. But again, that will be evaluated in future years. And so the next slide really drives home kind of the comparison between the two approaches. So what we have here in the dashed line, and this is just for sewer, is the where the revenues have been and the projection using that glide path approach. And then what's shown here in the green is the break-even approach. So instead of the 4%, you could have kept rates, you know, steady for a couple of years, but then you would have seen some pretty significant increases over the past couple of years. And then in 22, you'd need about a 30% increase in the rates under that break-even approach. And so on the next slide, it just drives home again that $5 million is the delta between our revenues and our revenue requirements in fiscal year 22. And in order to meet that delta, you're going to be using some net position in the coming years that has been accumulated in order to address the need for the increases coming forward. And so finally, just some summary thoughts in terms of the rate projections. I will say that we're dealing with the COVID impacts with a lot of our clients around the country, and a lot of them are in really bad shape in terms of needing to do some pretty significant increases at a time when they don't really want to. So your prior year rate adjustments have really prepared you well for the current events. And under that preparedness, we are of the opinion that you can keep your rates steady in fiscal year 21 with the financial position you're in. But we do need to strike the balance, as we've shown through the slides, that particularly on the sewer side, that in order to address that deviation from the plan with the 0%, you'll have to do some future rate adjustments that are probably above the prior projections. And or you'd have to delay some non-regulatory planned capital improvement projects. And then finally, hopefully, there will be some future federal infrastructure stimulus dollars that will allow you to offset some of the cost of projects. And it's important to emphasize there that having those projects in a position to be shovel ready really puts you in a good position to receive those funds. But all in all, I can't emphasize enough in terms of the financial position that the city is in to be able to address these difficult times. And so that should be noted, as we're not seeing that with a lot of communities around the country. So with that, I'll turn it back over to you, Brian.
Thank you, David, as well. And also, I think here on the Seacoast, especially related to water, there are a number of wastewater systems experiencing double-digit rate increases. Exeter, Newmarket, Dover, close to that. So. On the proposed budgets, very quickly, there's a lot of detail in the budget book. We didn't print it here for brevity's sake. Just summarize both the water and sewer proposed cash requirement budgets and the delta changes. And as you can see overall, on the water side, just a small decrease in budget related to mostly a rolling stock, cut back a bit on the needs there, just a few other minor things. But on the water side, fairly steady state on the budget needs there. But again, as David said, the 2% increase that was projected last year is really associated with about a little over $20 million of future capital needs for that's in our capital improvement program. So again, to prepare for the financing of those needs. So again, just a repeat of where that breakdown shows and how it breaks out as far as the operations and maintenance and the personnel versus what we do in the capital. I'll turn it over to Terry to go a little bit on the sewer side.
First, so here we have a very similar slide to what you saw from Brian on the sewer requirements. We have the items here on the left, general categories, total cash requirement at the bottom. You can see that year over year, there is an increase for sewer. And I'll walk through what some of those major increase items were, but there's about a 1.9% increase on the cash requirement between fiscal year 20 and fiscal year 21. You'll see that the major ones here are related to operation and maintenance at a little over $700,000 increase, and then permit and legal fees, and we'll walk through those. You'll also see towards the bottom that there is a significant increase in the cost associated with debt repayment, and that's related, as David Heider had mentioned earlier, to the repayment of the Pearson State Revolving Loan Fund loan. Next slide, please, Brian. We have here the major categories. You know, again, 21% for personnel, salaries, and benefits. 41% is related to capital and debt service. We have very little in comparison to previous years for capital requests in this fiscal year 21. So this is primarily driven by repayment of previously authorized expenses. Then we have the operation and maintenance side. And on the next slide, I'll talk about some of the differences we've seen over between fiscal year 20 and 21. So one of the items is this O&M costs. These are really driven by the upgrades at the Pearson facility for the most part. And at the Pearson facility, while it is it's a much higher level of treatment, that results in the need for additional costs associated with electricity, chemicals. We have additional buildings there for heating. And as a result of doing additional treatment, we end up generating additional sludge. So for chemicals, we are looking at about a $245,000 increase at Pearson. For heating, there's about a $23,000 increase for new buildings. And then we have for sludge hauling and disposal, there's approximately $289,000 increase. There's a little over $100,000 in Pearson for all the consumable components associated with the biological aerated filter. So that system is highly automated. So it has a lot of pneumatics. And when we talk about consumables associated with things like that, it's things like replacing filters and other items associated with the specialized equipment that does the treatment. So there's a fair amount of additional repair items in this budget. On the side of the Pease Wastewater Treatment Facility, we do have the new Headworks building. That new Headworks building, as Brian alluded to earlier, does have a fair amount of new equipment and additional equipment compared to our old out of service building. So there's an additional electrical cost coming on from our heat plant, as well as that facility's continuing to age. While we're doing some capital improvements, there's still a lot of work that needs to be done to keep old aging equipment up to speed, and that comes at a cost. So there's a fair amount of money in this budget for the repairs associated with facility improvements at Pease. On the permit side, this is an item related to the Great Bay Total Nitrogen General Permit, as we mentioned earlier in last evening. And essentially, there's a number of components in that permit that require the city, should it become, when it becomes final, to conduct water quality monitoring in the estuary. So as a result of knowing that that could potentially become a final permit in fiscal year 21, we decided to put about a $200,000 line item in for that work. We had previously, in other years, been conducting water quality monitoring. The offset was about $50,000, so that's why you see an increase here of $150,000. Next item, Brian. We also wanted to provide the City Council with kind of a summary of the contracted services that we use. Given that we have complicated equipment for the water and sewer departments, particularly on the treatment side, we have regulatory requirements, we do have to rely on contracted services frequently. So here we have kind of a summary of some of the major categories, and I'll run through the dollar amounts at the bottom, but we often use certified laboratories that we bring our water samples to conduct the sampling for our regulatory reporting. Our staff members are often trying to do work at the facility that might require some assistance from the engineering side. As an example, we had to close up a hole in an existing floor, and that required the sizing of a beam to support the floor. While our staff is doing the work, we had to rely on an engineering firm to give us the proper sizing of that particular beam. So that we do rely on engineers for that type of assistance. We use an outside firm to do wastewater flow monitoring for the combined sewer overflows. So there's a lot of instruments in the combined sewer overflows. They're in a pretty nasty environment underneath the road. And the data that we provide to the regulators is completely validated every month. So it's actually a pretty specialized system or specialized practice. So we contract that work out. We have a fair amount of equipment, as I mentioned, that's pneumatics and other type of stuff. We have a lot of generators and other type of equipment that requires specialty service. So we have contracts for those type of items. We occasionally have to remove hazardous debris from the sewer system or from the pumping stations. This is kind of a buildup of some of the stuff that's in the sewer that eventually gets congealed to the point where it has to be removed with a separate company. We have a lot of equipment that does the measurement of our flow, whether it's for water or air for some of the valves and controls, but a lot of that work requires specialty calibration. We occasionally have to rent equipment to conduct our work. So we have equipment rental as contracted service. Brian has mentioned a number of times the work that we've done with a leak detection firm for the water division, water distribution system. This has been definitely worth it, has significantly reduced what we refer to as lost water. And sometimes we have to rely on a specialist to do pipe inspections for different types of conditions that occur. And lastly, we do contract out our sludge and grit removal. So you'll see down at the bottom of this slide here that we have the two departments, water and sewer. The primary categories are sludge and grit removal. The heavy side for sludge and grit removal is clearly Pierce Island and the wastewater side of things, where we generate sludges as part of the treatment process, but that also happens as part of water as well. It's a different type of sludge, and it gets hauled off and handled differently. Under the professional contracted services, that really, those costs are really what we've talked about, everything else up above, and there's a number of other categories that kind of fall in that overall need of contracted services.
Okay, just a few slides and then we can get into questions. Want to cover briefly the stormwater budget. A couple of years ago, we created a special revenue fund to track stormwater, and this is predominantly associated with the additional costs and the compliance requirement of the EPA's MS4 stormwater permit, which has a lot more regulatory requirements to it, a lot more field work, The snapshot on the right are some of our interns and staff out last summer doing inventory and ranking of outfalls and mapping updates of our stormwater system, a requirement that all miles of stormwater, all catch basins, all outfalls be mapped. And we've updated our maps and have a very comprehensive map, which is a fortunate thing to have. And very useful as far as the needs to track if we were to have issues with the stormwater. Dry weather outfall screening and sampling also took place last year. We identified and inspected 202 sites that needed to be inspected, and 23 of those were identified for dry weather sampling and for follow-up, which we are continuing to do. Lastly, on the stormwater, a very, very big component, and just recently a mailer went out to our residential customers, and we had a public meeting last November where we introduced a little shout out to Stephanie Secord, who's worked with us on Think Blue, and we'll be promoting more and more Think Blue campaign here in Portsmouth for our residents and business and all property owners to think blue in everything they do, essentially, because stormwater is something with 71% of the community, city of Portsmouth, in private hands, all the land. It's highly important that we work in partnership with, you know, everybody that lives here and owns property to do what they can to protect and keep the waters clean. We're out there, we've put new storm drain markers out. We did a scoop the poop flyer and also signs that are up at parks for people when they get a dog license. And it's a reminder when you're out there and your dog does its business that you pick it up and, you know, take it with you. Also last fall, we had a residential mailer out to our residents about good, proper disposal of leaves and yard waste, that it just doesn't go, you don't sweep it into the street, nor do you, you know, rake it into any kind of water outfall, and also lawn care efficiency. So with that, I'm going to talk about another huge component. When we went to the sewer revenue fund, and when we did the approach and went before council a few years ago with Peter Rice and I, it's kind of a team effort, a lot of work here at Public Works, especially related to the stormwater, involves the highway department because we're in streets. So we work in concert with not only the highway department, but our trees and greeneries. There's a lot of maintenance. So on the stormwater side, a big thing that is required when you have these facilities, you have to keep them clean and keep them maintained. And what you can see on the left side of this slide are the totals we did last year of catch basin cleanings, the amount of material. We got close to 260 tons of material that was removed from the catch basins and inspected. We have our own camera and inspection system for our drain and sewer lines. And a street sweeper that's out collected close to 300 tons of material after sweeping close to 800 miles of streets last year. So again, this will continue. One thing that will, budget-wise, this is our budget. The only increase you see this year from last year is really just because we are out there maintaining these systems and we're inspecting, we're finding the deficiencies. So the expense here is predominantly the cost of you know, the bricks and the outfall materials, the pipes, all the materials we need to actually do the maintenance work. So that's really the differential you see here from FY21 versus FY20. What's not shown here, and just as a prelude to what we anticipate being, and certainly a lot of this may tie in with the Great Bay general permit if things go that way with the wastewater side that ties in stormwater, there will be quite a bit of capital needs in future years for stormwater. That's something Again, with all the work we're doing with staff and all the inventorying and checking on compliance, we also work regionally with the Seacoast Stormwater Coalition. They actually are meeting tomorrow virtually. But it's all the communities around here, all the our peers that are doing the same thing, and we are working together on approaches that we can combine efforts to be as efficient as possible in addressing, you know, these future needs for stormwater. So with that, I can turn it back over to the city manager. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian, and thank you to the team. And Mayor, I think at this point we will turn it over to you for questions, comments.
Thank you. Anybody have any questions, comments, concerns? I've got Councilor Huda and then Councilor Trace.
Okay, so I guess my last question, to touch on that last slide that you just had up there, Brian. If I look in the book, page 399 on stormwater, we have professional contracted services of 43,000 in there. It's mostly engineering. So where did that drop down into other operating, or am I looking at this wrong? So you have 75 and 78. Are you including that in there?
Hey, let me go to that page again. Yes, and there's also the sludge disposal that is, I believe, part of that component as well.
Okay, can I move on? Can we stay in stormwater and I move on to another question in there? This one is personnel related. And since so much of the water and sewer are allocated services from all over the, from more of the municipal services, I went through and I looked at the allocation, the big page with all the allocations on there. And I did have a question on a process intervention technician. On that page, it says it's 50% water and it's 50% stormwater. So I'm not seeing that guy in here, but he was in sewer. So is this an oversight or which one is correct?
What page that might be on?
So let's go back to page 153 in the budget book.
Brian, I believe that's probably the GIS stormwater tech.
No, it says process.
I understand, but I think it was just mislabeled.
Okay, so because we do have another GIS stormwater tech down further, Peter, and he's in there. That I didn't have. I found that one.
Mm-hmm. Page 153.
Yeah, top of the page there, it's a process instrumentation tech.
Oh.
Is he supposed to be in stormwater or is he supposed
to be? No, that should be sewer. That is a typo.
Okay, so we're
50%
good.
50% water, 50% sewer.
Okay, awesome.
Good catch.
Okay, so my next question, actually, I don't know who to address these to, so. Anybody can help, I appreciate it. My question is in sewer, and in there's two lines that are quite large here. The interest on the debt and the depreciation. So my question on that is, we're looking at almost $5 million here between the two of them and the rest of the changes. And from my experience, I was wondering how we got a net difference between the two years of $2,750,000 on depreciation. Does this mean we put the plant into service or?
I don't know if Judy wants to answer this or not, but I know that we, portions of the
facility, because it's been such a long construction, have been online for years at this point. So this year we went through the exercise of starting to depreciate the portions of the work that we could, which were online, have been accepted and have been running.
That's correct. That's equipment out there.
Okay, so, and is this like for the 20-year life? I mean, the number is big, so
they vary depending on the equipment, and it could range, you know, some of the useful life is a long time for some of that equipment out there, so it varies.
Okay, so is the plant officially online as far as that goes then, or is it I picked that up when somebody said 22. So are we getting to see another big bump in here in 22 for that?
For depreciation,
yeah.
Yes, you will.
Okay, and same thing with the debt service. It's $1,000,520. Is that also because it's coming online, or can you help me out on that one?
No, she's looking at just the interest on debt.
Yeah.
So the $4.1 million is interest on debt.
Mm-hmm.
Is the accrued interest in there?
No, that's the expense.
Yeah. That's the expense of the interest of existing debt that's already on the books. It's not the treatment plan.
Okay, so we could probably anticipate another increase next year when we say this is going to come online then. Or are we going to bring this online in phases?
It's accruing
the interest. I misspoke on that one, Councilor Huda. I was reading the wrong line. There's $4.5 million that's existing debt. The 4.1 is the interest on the debt as it will come online.
Councilor Judy, you know, and Terry, step in if I'm misspeaking here. The city's using what's called the State Revolving Loan Fund, and the benefit of that is you're able to borrow money and only pay 1% on the loan until you're substantially, or 1 year after substantial completion. So when the project's declared substantially complete, you have the total asset that you've benefited from, but you haven't started paying for it for another year.
I know.
So what David Hyder pointed out was that $5 million bump in 22 is what we anticipate when that full debt service comes on.
Okay, so. And
based on how we're tracking with the treatment plant, that first payment and the interest would have to be paid in fiscal 22.
So I'm confused still. So what is this in 21? Is it the same thing?
We have existing debt from other projects. If that's what you're, why are we paying an existing principal in interest?
No, I'm asking Peter why the increase in this year is so large.
If I could go to a different page in the budget document, which might help a little bit. Okay. It would be page 381, Councilor. Okay. So the enterprise funds are a full accrual basis of accounting, and what we have to do, and some of the slides that Terry had up for the sewer in the presentation, we have to convert the full accrual basis of accounting to a cash requirement so that we can calculate the user rate. So the pages of 381 actually kind of helps in that translation from a full accrual to a cash requirement. If you notice, if you're there, and
I'm here.
Okay. So there's three, like midway at the top part of the box, there's two columns. There's a full accrual basis of accounting column and a cash requirements column, okay? So you'll see in the middle, you'll see the 4.1 million and then a negative 1.6 million pretty much, and then 4.5 million. The 4.5 million is the debt that's on is the principal payment on existing debt. So the 4.1 is the interest that we'll need as an expense. So that's the total expense for the interest for that year. The 1.6 million nets out, that's the accrued interest. So the total amount would be the principal payment, and then the interest payment would net the 4.1 and the 5.6, which is $2.5 million. So that's the actual cash piece that will be required. So it's kind of confusing because we do a table for conversion, but it's the way that we have to do that in order to calculate the actual user rate. Okay. If you notice, like on the left-hand side of the page, on that column depreciation, the 5.1 million, you know, these are non-cash items. So there's, you know, we're not, right, okay.
Okay, I just noticed it because it was so large as compared to 18 and 19 right. And even 20. That's why I was looking at that. Okay, I have one more question, and this is kind of high level, and it might be for Mr. Hyder. So in looking at the water and sewer rates for the last 16, 17, 18, and 19, when we estimated our revenue came in below budget for about, I don't know, 4 or 5 years. So my question is for this year, for eliminating the water, well, I guess, and it did that for both water and sewer, for eliminating the any increase that was in our previous table, we also decreased the amount of revenue in here for FY21. So is it a good thing, or are we going to be punished going forward, depending on how things go at the plants, for kind of pushing off this rate increase?
Well, I guess a couple of responses. One would be that every time, and Brian tracks it very closely, but every time we do a projection of revenues, we're basing it on anticipated usage. And depending on weather conditions and industrial use and things of that sort, it's not uncommon for your revenue projections to be, you know, not spot on, typically some variation. And we have seen some shortfalls in terms of, and they've been fairly minor in terms of revenues in comparison to the forecast. But I will say that's not uncommon. And you don't always spend, on the flip side, your expenditures aren't always exactly what you say you're going to spend. So there's some play that happens there as well. And so to answer the second part of your question, as I mentioned, I think, you know, you are well positioned given that you do have some net position to handle if revenues do deviate from the projections due to the COVID impacts. You know, if all of a sudden you see a 30% decline over the next 3 months, that's another story. But based on what Brian's seeing in the usage data, it doesn't appear to be that significant at this point. But it's something that needs to be monitored. Would it help if you did an increase? It certainly would. It would continue to, you know, put you on that trajectory. But we're not of an opinion that you're creating an unsustainable system by not doing the increase. If that helps answer your question.
Yep. Thank you.
No problem.
Councilor Huda? I'm sorry, not Councilor Trace. Next.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I have a couple of questions. I guess my question would be first for Terry. And when the Pierce Island Wastewater Treatment Facility was first looked at, you're now talking about, I'm going to jump for a second. You're now talking about how there is, every time the permitting comes in lower, that we're going to be paying more in the way of chemicals and the way of electricity. Yet I'm looking at the electrical here for the Pierce Island plant, and it doesn't change. Grit does, and your chemicals do, but electrical does not. Electrical sits at 400,000 both this year and last year, or I mean next year. So I'd like an explanation of at what point will we see an increase in electricity. I'd also like to know what the chemicals are that we are using and whether there's been any change in those chemicals from what was originally projected to be used, if that makes sense. And obviously you could hear from the fact that my dog was tearing the door down that my husband just arrived home.
Sure. So on the electrical side, or for the treatment plant as a whole, we've been through the process of between using the rate model and some of the estimates from our consulting engineer when we were initially developing the design for this project. We had a whole list of things that, you know, projections for increases in operational costs. Last year, we thought that we would start to see that increase in the electrical costs because we had just transferred the service and put it online from what used to be out behind Shapley Island to the front side of the plant. We didn't end up realizing a significant increase in those electrical costs, but we are starting to see them now. So what we did is we left this year over year for electricity. Uh-huh. We do expect there's a possibility that long-term next year or the year after, we still have to increase it. But we felt that we're comfortable that the $400,000 was reasonable for this particular year. Obviously the chemicals went up. That's a result of our need to remove nitrogen.
Right.
So the chemical costs, it's really about between the couple different phases of treatment, we have to add a chemical to help the bugs do their job to actually do the final stage of nitrogen removal. And that that costs money. So those chemicals cost money and they're expensive.
What is the chemical that you're currently using?
Sure, it's a product called Micro C.
Oh, okay.
And there's really only two options. There's methanol, which is highly
or Micro C.
Yeah, or Micro C, and we elected Micro C given the sensitive area in which we have to drive the chemicals through. So that's why you didn't see the bump in electrical costs. Now, regarding the chemicals, were you talking about amount or type? Because our chlorination, dechlorination, the disinfection systems, all the same chemicals. Only thing that we're really adding here is the Micro C for the most part.
I guess what I'm driving at is, has anything changed in the decision or the process of, as your regulations get more and more strict, are you looking at changing what you're using, and is the cost going to go up, and was this something that the city thought about when we went with the BAF system?
Yeah, so the BAF system, as designed, has the flexibility to go to the low limits already. So that was one of our reasons behind selecting that particular process. But really, the thing that drives that is that capital cost associated with the additional chemical needed to get from one level to a lower one.
Right. I would respectfully suggest that it has the ability to touch the lower limits. It has not yet been proven that it can operate consistently at 0.3 here in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, on a consistent basis. My next question is, why do we have $100,000 in storm drain improvements under sewer and not under the stormwater special revenue fund? Is there a reason for putting that in sewer and not in stormwater?
Stormwater, the special enterprise or special revenue fund set up for sewer was funded, or sorry, for stormwater was funded 50% from sewer and 50% from the general fund. So that's why there's a transfer line in the sewer budget.
Okay, and is that the same reason why under capital projects, we have Maplewood Avenue and Willard both 50-50 in water and in sewer? So that you're
a little bit different, I would say. So those particular items fall under the combined capital improvement items, where they're, you know, we're essentially for Maplewood as an example, it has utilities, but is primarily because it's a bridge falls under the general fund highway. So it's covering the utility costs for the design for Maplewood. It's very common for us for the sewer separation projects to fund from water, sewer, and from the general fund. So a lot of it still comes from sewer because it's a sewer separation driven project, but there's still contribution for components of that work from both the water enterprise fund and the general fund from highway for things like roadway reconstruction and sidewalks.
And I guess my last couple of questions or question revolves around rolling stock and the fact that both in water and sewer, rolling stock in one is 423,000 and rolling stock in the other is 360,000. And rolling stock in sewer has miscellaneous equipment at 150,000 and in water is miscellaneous equipment at 100,000. I mean, that's $250,000 that's just kind of miscellaneous. And I guess I wonder why there isn't more documentation or more why it isn't broken down when it's that kind of money. And maybe that seems small in comparison to a $5 million depreciation next year, but in this COVID world, every little bit counts, and $250,000 between the two departments. I assume it's bits and pieces and pipes and screws, but it'd be kind of nice to have us look at that or go back and look at it. And my one last thing is the leaky bridge. The sewer pipe underneath the Pierce Island Bridge. And I seem to remember that we did a bladder replacement. Was it both pipes or just one pipe when we did that 2 years ago that was going to solve all the problems of the world until we replaced the bridge? Terry, you're on mute.
So the bridge itself is not leaking, but yes, you're right. One of the two sewer pipes underneath is.
Yes.
So 2 years ago, we discovered the other pipe that is not leaking, and it was a problem. So at that time, we ended up having to replace it. We tried some alternatives to fix it. They didn't work.
That was the bladder?
It's called the liner.
Right.
The liner, unfortunately, did not work. We didn't have to pay for it at the end of the day, but we had to end up replacing the pipe. On the opposite side of the bridge, which is on the State Fish Pier side, is where our current is at. We've uncovered that, looked at it. It has very similar signatures in terms of the deterioration. We suspect it might be actually exterior corrosion from the salt water. Either way, we're looking for a fix at this point. We're still trying to evaluate a much lesser extensive fix than what we had to do on the other side of the bridge. So I don't have a conclusion on it at this moment, but we're still looking at it, and you know, we'll have some approach in the near future.
Thank you very much.
Great. So I've got next, I've got Councillor Kennedy and then Councillor Tabor.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for that presentation. Terry, I have a couple questions. One is citizen's question about the pipe issue on the bridge. And since we're on that topic, we'll just continue there. They want to know how much is leaking into the waterway. Do we have an idea of how much you're leaking an hour?
Sure. So we once we identified the leak, we went, there's valves on either side of that bridge. And the valves we can use to completely isolate that section of pipeline. So we've done that. There happens to be still a drip that's occurring because the pipe has water in it. So it's much, much less than what was occurring. We have to give estimates when we call this stuff into the regulators. We told them it was no more than 500 gallons in the initial leak that occurred while it was still operating. That was our best estimate. It happened to leak more when the pumps were on at the station and less when they stopped, obviously, and slowed down. So completely isolated that section. And now we're focused on the repair and fix.
So when you isolate, does that mean that pipe, the other pipe is doing double duty, or what does that mean?
It means that all of our flows that we're sending up to Pearson are going through the one other pipe. Okay. So it's only a certain amount of water that can go through it, but it's all our normal flows can go through that pipeline.
Thank you. And my second question on the sewage, before I get to the water, is given that all these hotels are shut down and everything is happening, given the environment we're currently in, we're not getting visitors, all the companies have shut down. I was curious if there was a savings or if there could be a savings in the amount of effluent you are pumping through. When we look at chemicals, when we look at a lot of things, I'm thinking with all this happening, that it would prove to be a substantial less amount of sewage going through our pipes. So I guess my curiosity is that, and that kind of goes along with my next question, so I'll do it at the same time and then you can answer it all. And the same thing for Brian. Given the fact the usage is way down, what is that going to do, if anything, with our what we're bringing in from other communities, what we're bringing in our city, for our revenues in sewer and water? Where does that all play given the situation? So maybe you can answer kind of an overview of giving us that little idea.
Counselor, good question. I have to apologize for Terry. He sent me a text. His internet went out. So I can pick up there. We have, currently with our metering system on the everyone is metered and we have a radio read system. So we can do some analysis, which we've done. Certainly we've seen a reduction in some of the commercial properties. On the flip side, our residential consumption seems to be up. And certainly, we have not lost that as far as, the effluent, the waste. So the flows, when we check with the sewer division, the flows are the same. Pease continues to, Sig Sauer and others are still working there. And our flows, again, at Pease are not down so much. So we're seeing, anywhere from maybe 10 to 15%. But that is, the April analysis and early May. I have to also point out that it's also been cool and wet. So, people are not irrigating yet, which, will likely be the case as summer wears on. So in incremental costs, you did mention the thing about our operations are, there's so many fixed costs. So yes, the gallons through might be down 10%, but our cost of operation doesn't go right in lockstep with that. It might be closer to, a percent less of cost because we still have personnel, we still have all the pumps, we still have, all the equipment that is running on that side.
Basically, what I was kind of trying to look at it, see if our usage is down, so our revenues are going to be down from the corporate side. I mean, the hotels and everything are down. So you're going to see a substantial loss there. If there was a way that we were picking, having a cost savings somewhere else to kind of offset the fact that we're not going to be pulling those revenues. So that's kind of why I was asking about gallons and that kind of thing.
Well, we are tracking that, and certainly, we're not too many weeks into that differential, but we can, as things progress, we'll report back on that.
When would you be able to, and I know you're speaking for Terry, so I apologize, Brian, but when would Terry, and I don't know if you can hear me, I see it's freezing in and out, but when would Terry be able to give us an idea of where we might be at before this budget goes?
As far as our revenue projections?
Yeah.
We should have our, before the budget, we'll have our May consumption data. Certainly what we looked at too is, the recovery from 2008, it's not totally analogous, but things bounced back very quickly in 2008. We do have new customers. We've got, just on Islington Street, occupancy is happening at the new condos there. So we do have new customers on board, and we have some big customers that are, continuing to use the water.
I'm not disagreeing, but I can't believe, I mean, I was looking back at the information we got a long time ago on the number of hotels, what they use. So I'm just curious. So if we can get some information before we do speculation, I'd rather deal with data. That would be great. The only other thing I have, and thank you, Terry. The only thing, and thank you, Terry, for working through Brian. The only thing I have for you, Brian, is I guess I'm curious. I, as you know, I've mentioned numerous times about where we're at with the Togan site and potential migration. And have we done anything with Dover? Have we looked at it? Is there going to be a cost potential? Is there anything out there that you can give us some insight on? And are we going to have to do some evaluation of that at all, which would be a funding cost, out of curiosity?
Counselor, well, if the analysis needs to be done, Dover is doing that. They are, as required, because it's a Superfund site. They have a consultant and their own staff that have been working on it. They have been working in concert with us on reservoir monitoring. They did some recent analysis. Unfortunately, the data from that showed, nothing migrating into the reservoir that was of any detectable level at the time. That doesn't mean the future wouldn't be that. But they continue to work through the EPA and requirements, and the EPA has directed them to do additional analysis, which it's our understanding they're doing. And our operations manager, Al Pratt, has been in communication with them, and also out in the field as well, check on that. So we can get a report back on that to you here with our latest information.
Thank you for that. And that'd be great if we get a report back. Again, I'm concerned that, I'm glad Dover's working on it, but obviously there's a need to work on it. So hopefully we can keep update, and if there's any information you can get to the council on their findings or their tracking of, that'd be appreciated. Thank you both.
Thank you. So I've got Councilor Tabor.
Yeah. Hi, Brian. Hi, Terry. Thanks for managing your headcount. I know that going into operating a new plant on a first full year, it's a little challenging to say we'll hold our headcount, but appreciate you holding that level. Three questions, one expense question, two rate questions. The $318,000 go-ahead in sludge and grit removal, is there anything we can do? Are there any best practices at the front end of the system to reduce that? I know nothing about sludge and grit, but is there any way that we could, through better practices, pull that number down?
Sure. The As far as sludging, grit removal, there are a little bit different. The grit tends to be the stuff that's carried out and brought removed upstream. The reason that we want to remove that upstream is because it can actually damage all the equipment downstream. So while it's an expense, it's a lot less expensive than letting it continue through the system and end up actually damaging from some of the downstream equipment. Related to the sludges, the sludge is really part of the biological treatment system. And as that biological treatment system is doing its work in order to remove the pollutants in the waste stream, it actually grows microbes, what we call biomass. And then we have to remove that in order to manage the amount of that biomass in the system to make sure that the treatment is optimal. So it's really a function of having this type of treatment system. There's really no way to reduce or eliminate it. The only thing that a lot of facilities do is manage it on the back end, once they've already gathered it, to try and change the form or reduce the volume. And we've looked at anaerobic digestion. You may have heard that term in the past. That's kind of the back end management of it to try and reduce the volume. But there's a lot of implications, both from capital and operational perspective, associated with that. And when we did the analysis, it was really not cost, it was cost prohibitive at the end of the day.
Okay. So that brings me to a second question. During a campaign, I knocked on the door of a guy who lives over in one of the gem streets, and he said the Milwaukee Municipal Sewer System has created a product called Milorganite, and it's a fertilizer, and it's made of heat-dried microbes, and they're selling it and making a lot of money. Is there any possibility with our sludge and our cast off material to recycle it in that way and make some revenue?
So I'm not totally sure of the specifics of the Milwaukee system, but there is a, when you do things like anaerobic digestion on the back end of the sludge collection, there's oftentimes a product that you can generate. It's called Struvite, and it's similar to what you're describing here. But it all has to be dealt with. It gets heated so that it's been, it's no longer has active bacteria in it. There's a liability component that you have to factor into that decision-making process as well. So I think that it's likely that it's part of a back-end manufacturing process with the sludge. I haven't seen it done any other way, because you have to be able to process it in a way that it's no longer has active bacteria that could harm people.
Okay. Last question is rates. I'm encouraged to hear that some of our big industrial users are still chugging away, particularly out of Pease. Maybe this is for the city manager. Did we ever consider just holding rates for residential and still putting the 4% in for commercial? It seems to me a hotel's going to have so much lower volume, they're not going to notice a 4% clawback on, to try and get some revenue. And I think of Lonza, which is pretty much pushing us into a sewer plant upgrade out at Pease. I kind of hate to forego the 4% on that.
Right. I'm excited to see that the DPW director has his hand up for this.
So Dave can probably better describe this. Dave Hardy can probably better describe this. But we legally have to have justification to differentiate a rate, or it'll be appealed to the Public Utility Commission. So Dave, maybe you can do a quick description on that.
Yeah, since it is a utility, Peter's right. If you do have differential rates, you have to justify it. And if you can justify that it actually costs you more to serve a specific type of customer, you can charge more. But generally, you'll get into legal issues if you're arbitrary and capricious.
So
rate setting be essentially up increase on one class over, and you would have differential rates, and you'd have to somehow justify that it cost you more to serve that class than another class.
Okay.
So counselor, we do have a couple surcharges that we charge some of the heavy industrial users that have stronger wastes. So we have calculated those based on what it costs to treat, and then therefore we have justification to do that. So at this point we would not recommend, and I don't think it's legally defensible, and I'd have to defer to Suzanne Woodland, our able legal counsel.
Well, I would quickly add that we also have tiered rates. So the larger customers do pay more generally than a residential, because they quickly go into that second tiered rate.
Right. And we get a lot of revenue from our big users like Fonza because of that. That's it.
All right. Now I've got Council Lazenby and then Council Whalen.
Sure. Thank you. Question, I guess, probably might be for David, but even the rest of the staff. Looking at the rate stabilization for the sewer rates, certainly appreciate that we had a goal of getting a 0% increase zero rate increase for both water and sewer. But I was a little concerned about, in the case of the sewer, what that meant for the next 3 years. So jumping from zero this year up to 5.5% each of the next 3 years. Have we done a model, or might we be able to see what it would look like to do a little less of a decrease? So if we decreased water by 2% down to zero, we decreased sewer by 2% down to 2% rather than decreasing it by 4%, would that help sort of ease those next 3 years? Because I think people are concerned that there'll be budget financial challenges, not just this year, but others. So is that something you've done, or is that something we might be able to look at?
So we, through the budget process, we've been running a bunch of different scenarios in terms of rate increases. And we certainly could look at 2%, and it would help. I mean, you certainly get more revenue on the sewer side, but you are in a position right now where, you know, we're comfortable with a 0%, just realizing that it will need to be a little bit higher in the future years, and it can potentially soften that by delaying some non-regulatory related projects. So, you know, I certainly can't disagree that it wouldn't help to have a little bit of an sewer increase, but you know, given what we've calculated, we are comfortable with the 0% at this point. And just in terms of, you know, if you go next year at 2.5% in 22 on water and 5.5% on sewer, that turns into about $52 per year of an increase for your typical residential customer. So that puts it into context in terms of the magnitude of the increase. So 5.5 sounds a bit high, but you know, if you divide that into a monthly bill, it's not huge.
Okay. Is that a difficult calculation to see? Nope. Just to see what that would look like?
No, it's...
I think, David, we can easily... Yeah. Oh, yeah. Show what a 2% could be, and that can be quickly done. Yep.
Yep.
Thank you.
All right. Great. So I've got Council Whalen.
Yeah, just a question on rates. There was a lot of discussion last year about adding another tier of rates in there. So you had another tier below the big, you know, the big customers. Is that legally defensible? Just to follow up on what John Tabor said. You know, if we added another tier.
Yeah, we would have to, as long as we have a justification for the cost. And so the way it works right now is that the capital component, and not to get into the weeds, but the capital component of the rate is actually the same. So there's when we come to cumulative rate, we have an operating component of the rate, and we have a capital component of the rate. And so as long as our capital component of the rate is the same for each tier, we can demonstrate that from an operational standpoint, it does cost more once you get into those higher demands on the system. And so that's how we could justify the differential. And I don't mean to complicate it by talking about the different components of the rate, but there is some guidance that we need to follow in terms of how to structure those tiers.
Yeah, I get that. I mean, you can't structure a system where the larger rate user is paying for the big capital component. It's got to be spread out.
Correct.
Among all the users.
Yep.
But that may be another way to kind of skin the cat here. Just another question for Peter and I guess Brian. Under stormwater, you know, we're currently just transferring money over into that enterprise fund. And I would think, you know, just thinking ahead here, you know, with this new Great Bay general permit, stormwater is going to become pretty critical managing going forward. And I'm just wondering if there's another way to get at that and where we're actually charging end users either on the amount of area they have or whatever, kind of a surcharge to help fund that and kind of relieving some of the burden from other users, if you know where I'm getting at, because the city long-term thinking ahead is going to be penalized by the amount of stormwater going into the river in Great Bay.
Correct.
And somehow we have to get at that. I mean, we as a city just spent $100 million with a new sewer plant, but you know, we're only spending $500,000 in stormwater right now. So that's going to become more critical for us moving forward. So I don't know if you guys want to comment on that.
Counselor. Yeah, you're absolutely correct. And you know, that's, you know, given all the things we have, we're juggling and things, where the permit is right now, it's very heavily data collection mode in terms of the permit. And with this new, you have the MS4 permit, which is the stormwater permit, and then you have the Great Bay permit. With the Great Bay permit coming into play, the two are going to start to come together, and there's going to be more capital requirements, and there's going to be more costs associated with it. And as these costs become more significant, it's going to become more challenging for the you know, to split the cost between the sewer and the general fund. And you're correct in that there are alternative ways. You can create an enterprise fund that captures impervious surface in the lots, and the beauty of that is that it's a fee for service, and you can capture some of these previously non-taxed properties. So it's a way to capture some revenues out of properties that you aren't able to get revenues from. So I mean, this is something we'd look forward to have further discussions with you all. It's going to be a real challenge to put it together in a defendable way. But the other communities in the seacoast are looking at the same thing. And one of the things, if you recall, is that because we're working with this stormwater coalition, we're trying to come up with a kind of a uniform approach so that businesses don't start shopping communities, so that because Portsmouth's progressive and they do something, we don't drive them into Stratham or we don't drive them somewhere else. So we want to do something that doesn't penalize Portsmouth and that's consistent. So it is something that we really look forward to having further discussions with you all. But it's something that we want to go into and make sure we do it, you know, with a lot of input from the public, you know, really, and these are policy decisions that the council really needs to, you know, be heavily involved in. And so we would anticipate coming back and probably doing an evaluation to look at it and to look at the options and do what ifs and how it would impact the average homeowner, how it would impact an average commercial user, so that you have an order of magnitude, so you're able to make a good policy decision.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else have any other questions?
Your Honor.
Okay, so I'm gonna do Councilor Tabor, then Councilor Trace, then Councilor Huda. We're going back around a second time.
I just wanted to know, for a typical residential user, holding to zero rate increase means about how much? How much do they save?
Well, on the water, we did a quick analysis, it was about $5 a year for a typical water user, and I believe around.
Was it $35?
$30.
Yep, that's correct.
For a sewer.
$40.
Total, yes, for the year.
Okay. So I've got Councilor Trace and then Councilor Huda.
I have two different quick things. One is, I guess I'm a little confused. I don't specifically, and it's probably me, I don't specifically see anything in the book pertaining to the outlay that the city will have with Sagamore Creek. And understanding that that's something that, according to the consent decree, has to be completed, am I right, by 2023? Or am I making that figure up? I know it's gotta be started by September, October, am I right, Suzanne? So I'm curious as to where that fits in the budget. And then my second question is to Brian, and maybe this is something that's a report back. I know that it sits in the CIP, but the issue of where we are with the two pipes under Little Bay.
So, Councilor, Terry, I don't think Terry's available. I think he's been kicked off the internet. Maybe
he keeps getting kicked off. Suzanne is still with us.
I believe the capital money's already, you'd see that in the capital, the CIP. It was previously funded, authorized monies.
Yes, it was, or 4.2, I believe.
Right. So that's why you didn't see it in the budget.
Yeah.
It's already existing. It's on the debt schedule on page.
146.
It's on the debt schedule.
Okay.
Thank you, Judy.
Yes. So that is a required project that needs to get underway, and hopefully soon we'll be coming to the city council with a full presentation and options for you to consider in terms of how to advance that project. And so that's coming.
And that cost, we've ascertained that 4.2 is going to handle everything to the satisfaction of the residents and the council, or are we...
So that depends on the choices that the council makes in terms of the cost apportionment. So we're going to be laying out those figures for you, but okay. It all depends on which elements you elect to fund as part of that construction project. And part of the reason why we did the survey is to try and get some better information from the residents in terms of who would want to connect right now, so that when we come to you with all of that information, you'll be able to make your choices based on here's the cost if we go and do the cost apportionment, you know, say under the scenario that was last discussed at the end of the year and then earlier this year. And so we'll have the dollar figure for that. So that's precisely it. But if, depending on the decisions that the council makes, there could be additional costs if you want to, you know, provide a different level of cost apportionment. So I know we were concerned that if everyone wanted to tie in right away as part of the initial construction project, and if the decision was made to fully fund all of the service laterals and the pumps and all of those associated costs, then you're going to be above that 4.2 million that's already appropriated. So we need to lay that out for you.
And that has to be done by this fall.
We have requested of the EPA a start time deferral. I've asked for, you know, starting, frankly, the beginning of next season in terms of starting construction. We have not asked for an extension yet on the deadline for completion, because we'd like to get before you and kind of understand what this project is going to look like, and who we're going to serve and how. And that way we'll be able to have a more informed conversation with EPA and the state and CLF and the other, you know, parties.
Is that going to require another modification of the consent decree, or are we going to be okay?
We will probably need an amendment But it may not need a full hearing. It depends on whether it's an material amendment, so non-material amendments to the consent decree. For example, when we moved the stormwater project, we got an extra year on that stormwater project. That's right. Happened on Department of Public Works. We didn't need to go to like a full hearing for that. All the parties agreed, EPA, DES, DLF. And so we did that without much process. You know, we signed a couple page paper and filed.
Okay. So I'm just going to chime in a little bit as far as so we keep on budget item kind of a thing. I just want to let the council know that two times the city manager, and correct me if I'm wrong, has made attempts to start to talk about this. But because of the COVID-19 and under the restraints that we're at, we felt, or staff felt and recommended, that we had time to be able to pursue that later on down the line. If that's something that really everyone wants to get into, we can go and ask the city manager to start bringing this up. We've all gotten emails from several of those residents that liked the last proposal. Now with so much time going by, I think we're not gonna have to restart that project, but at the same time to really inform everyone, inform the council, because this council really has not addressed or seen any real presentations of this at all. This was left off from the last council that we inherited. So I just wanna kind of keep on track. And if that's something that everybody wants, we will definitely go. I will make a recommendation to the city manager that we start to address that sooner rather than later. So I've got Councilor Huda that was next. And then Councilor Tabor, you had your hand back up again. And then Councilor Kennedy just had her hand up. So we'll go with that.
Councilor Huda. From my perspective, I kind of want to, there's an nagging question about revenues for me. And my question is, back in 2019 on the industrial type, what we did was we budgeted, we took a big jump in our budgeted number from 2 million to 4 million. And what happened was the actual didn't come in. We were short by 1,391,000. So my question is, as this was carried forward, it was carried forward into FY20 and now into FY21, we're decreasing a little bit, but we're still up, kind of up high there. Was there an incident or an occurrence that caused us to budget that number with such an increase in our revenues? And I guess the second part of that is that still going on, or is that something that's gone away?
Councilor, if I may, that really attributes to our big customer at Pease that is working on an increase of flow on the wastewater side. And if that were to, you know, occur, then, you know, the additional water would, you know, be yielded as revenue. So it just hasn't occurred as quickly, but you know, some of the build out of their building has occurred. And if they get through permits, and also we deal with, you know, a business that, you know, itself has to have contracts and the ability to, you know, actually do the work they're gonna do based on, you know, those contracts they have.
So, okay, I guess I could say it. So this is probably based on Lonza coming online then? Because this is in sewer?
Yes.
So are we anticipating that if it didn't happen in this year, are we still gonna take that forward into 21, or do we have to worry about these revenues being overestimated as far as that goes? Or is this gonna be kind of, this is the way we anticipate it being going forward?
Well, there are certainly a lot of variables, and again, you know, one most critical thing at the moment is the wastewater permitting that's ongoing. So that, you know, very complex in that respect, and you know, I don't have a full timeline on when we totally anticipate that happening. Suzanne is on, maybe she could chime in, but that crystal ball is not you know, yet to totally give us an end date.
And I can just say that as part of the submission that we made to the EPA for the expansion at the Pease plant, Terry and his team did survey all the users at the Pease trade port and updated their numbers. So, you know, I'm assuming that what you see there is maybe the estimates based on their having done work earlier this year in terms of understanding what is coming down the pike, not only for Lonza, but for other users out of the trade port.
So we're pretty comfortable with that number then? Is that what everybody's saying?
I think so, yeah.
Okay, one other question. Okay, on the water side, I'm noticing that the Air Force gave us money for well treatment and well design in 2019, and it wasn't budgeted. Is there anything else that we're gonna get that isn't budgeted?
On the from the Air Force? Yeah, those items do not go into the budget. Actually, they're on the side because we have to see them as revenue. We do incur the expense, but it is reimbursed. The Air Force actually just last week in our recent agreement, they've agreed to fully fund a staff person. So we've got this new facility. It's very complex. And we said, look, you know, we're going to need additional staff for this, and we are getting funding to reimburse us for that staff. So we're going to have an additional staff person to fully manage that site. So those costs, again, they're not an expense for us, but, you know, because it'll zero out with the money we get reimbursed from the Air Force.
Okay, so it won't be a bump in our revenue. It'll be just be a net zero.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
So then I've got Councilor Tabor and then Councilor Kennedy.
Yeah, I just want to follow up on the volume drops. That's a little concerning. It's more than a little concerning, I guess. Water and sewer are 25 million revenue, or they were in 2019. If we had a 10% drop in volume, would that translate to a $2.5 million drop in revenue? Or even if it's only half of that at 5%, that's $1.25 million. Basically, every percent we're down $250,000 in revenue. Would that be correct?
Yes, that's correct. You have a little, you have a fixed charge on your on the water side that generates a little bit of fixed revenue, but vast majority is usage.
So how's our net position if we had to absorb $2.5 million?
So you do have sufficient net position at this point to be able to withstand that. It's important to remember too that if it's, it would have to be 5% for the entire year. So if you see a dip in 1 month of 10%, that equates to a, you know, obviously a smaller amount throughout the entire year. And fortunately, this is, you know, it's, as Brian mentioned, it's just difficult right now to know what the results are, because we are seeing, we have a number of clients in New England that are seeing lower usage, primarily that because of weather impacts, that April was rather wet. Because we do, for those communities that haven't had those weather impacts, we're seeing a pretty substantial, you know, 15 to 20% increase in residential usage, just because folks are using so much more at home.
Yeah, I mean, we all hope that this comes back, and yes, April is the got to be the worst month ever, because it's a lockdown month. Is there any place else we can go in cost if we had to try and offset some big revenue decline? Seemed difficult with a fixed cost structure of, you know, debt service and the payroll.
So, Councilor, you know, as you said, you know, we have the net position that we're fortunate compared to many, many other communities that aren't in the same position. You know, as a practice, the policy is to maintain a 20 to 30% net position for situations just like this. You know, we see this as a transitory situation, We believe our clients will continue to use water. Lawns is a great example. The power companies, the demand is going to come back. And if there continues to be a decline, we will have to adjust our projects and how we operate to come into line so that we keep the rate increases at an acceptable level. We understand it's a balance, and we are fortunate compared to many communities to have be in the position that we're not jacking the rates up significantly as this new treatment plant comes online. The Exeter, Brian pointed out, Exeter is seeing significant increases in their sewer rates. Newmarket's the same. Durham had increases significantly. So we're in line to weather this situation. We're fortunate that we have the net position to get us through it, and we need to make sure where we're using the net position, we need to make sure we adjust future capital outlays so that we don't push ourselves into a situation where we have rate spikes.
Yeah, I mean there's a follow-on effect if we draw down the net position, because that was built up to cover the increase in the Pierce Island debt service. So, that it comes back to bite us a little bit next year and the year after that, right?
It can if we don't adjust our capital programs and see some future rate increases. So it's a combination of things. We've worked very hard, and the council has made really good decisions to put us in this position. So we feel very comfortable that we're going to be able to get through this, and that the city is going to be able to provide a stable water source and treat to these higher levels for the wastewater side, and be able to continue to provide reasonable rate increases into the future.
No, it's a wonderful example of prudent storing away nuts for the winter. so we're in remarkable shape compared to other municipalities. Thanks.
Thank you. Councilor Kennedy.
Just 2 points. One, in answer to the Sagamore Ave, I would like to wait before we have a conversation. It sounds like Attorney Woodland was brought up that they were going to try to get some information more from the residents. I think there is a little confusion of different things out there. So I hope we do get that information before we have a conversation. And lastly, I'm glad Mr. Tabor continued on with what I was trying to bring up. Appreciate that. I am concerned. And I know that we feel at this point we're doing and moving in the right direction financially, given the loss of potential revenue. However, my concern is not today only, and what does the future look like? So I was a little concerned. I love the fact that we try to give the residents a break, but I am a little worried about that, given the potential loss of revenue. So I'm glad everyone's feeling good about it. I don't think I'm feeling as good about it, given that potential loss of revenue. So I just needed to say that. Thank you.
Great. Anyone else? Okay, I'll go now. So if you have something to add before that, Brian.
I was just going to quickly say we can do that analysis and update what different percentages might be. It seems that it kind of been echoed by a number of councilors. And if I could, Mayor, real quickly, Councilor Therese's question on the water line under the bay. Just an update, Councilor. Our engineer was out just last week doing borings in the bay that were required for the permit. So that was done just last week, in fact. And so they are taking that data back, and they'll be working on the latest design, which we're trying to fast track that project. Again, possibly might be a shovel ready, but not to mention, we certainly want to get a design just in case, we were to have a failure of the pipe, we'd have a method of fixing. So thank
you. That's my concern. Thank you.
Ours too.
Thank you very much. So first question is for Terry. So Terry, paying attention while you were making your presentation, in this budget, you've got some more upgrades for the sewer treatment plant out at Pease, maintenance issues and stuff like that. A dollar figure approximately, what is that?
Sure. So we have, for Pease, we had nearly $100,000 worth of repairs that were split across a number of different things, the facilities, valves and pipes, pumps, and other smaller items. So we have, this is stuff that staff likely would be doing themselves, but that the plant is just old. These things have been running for a long time, and we're just trying to keep up with it.
No, I agree. I was in hopes that maybe with that 100,000, it would have been taken into consideration. Seems that we've already gone and segmented $42 million for the upgrades that were there, that $100,000 thrown back on top of this year's. And some people may not think that that's a lot, but I learned one thing from John Bohinkle, all the years of paying attention to him in 2 years on the council, that for every $55,000, that's 1 cent on the tax rate. So just $100,000, another compile on top of this one, it wouldn't be taking, I guess, off the lump sum of the 42, which we all know is going to grow substantially more than the 42 million.
Thank you.
So the next question is for David, and I liked everyone's thought as far as with Councilor Whalen and Councilor Tabor really going after the rate increases. This is something else that has been talked about before, and I want David to really consider this. You talked about we'd have to go and do justification in order to be able to go and separate the two. Mm-hmm. Would we have to justify if a sewer treatment plant was only providing services for commercial identities? So we have two, one is serving commercial and residential, the other one is doing just commercial. Mm-hmm. Would we have to justify to create, let's call it, whether it be a tier package or whether it be a commercial rate? And the reason why I asked the commercial rate, David, is because not one of them that are out there, the businesses, I know they provide and they do great deals of stuff, but no one has complained or has any rate reductions when it comes to being charged a commercial rate for natural gas. Mm-hmm. I learned a little bit about this a few years ago when I rented the space, there were two rates. And I'm really hoping that we can create something like that to alleviate the above and beyond expenditures that we are going to acquire as Pease gets further. Mm-hmm.
And Your Honor, they will all be the first in line to get abatements.
Yes, thank you.
We had a 72,000 square foot plan and we tried.
Thank you. So any thoughts to that, David?
Well, and just when we say justify, we would not have a basis for the charge. We wouldn't have to justify it to the state corporation commissioner or anything like that. But and so yes, you can, as much as you'd like to, you could parse out separate customers, whether they're served just by a specific plant or whether they're served in a specific area, as long as you have you can justify the differential in terms of why you're charging them what you're charging them. You couldn't arbitrarily say we're going to charge $50 per 1,000 gallons for commercial just because we don't think they're going to squeal. And no, I know that's not what you're...
I get it. And the thing is just, Lonza is expanding, over a million square feet. The usage is going to go up. We do have to upload our capacity level due to that and a brewery that's down the road. Right. There's no residences that are out there. I understand that they are, let's see, I believe it was Mr. Bohinkle said 12% of the contributing of the overall water and sewer fund and package. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, if they're the greater user, we should be able to justify a commercial rate on that. And I like some of the other counselors talking about it, and I'd like it to be explored further. So Suzanne, you had your hand up. So
Just keep in mind that there is an agreement that governs the relationship between the city and the Pease Development Authority with regards to the operation of that sewer plant and how rates are treated, and it has to be equal. So what we do in Portsmouth applies at Pease, what happens at Pease applies in Portsmouth, so it has to be the same. They are treated just the same. So recognize that if there is going to be any If one could justify, as David Heider said, you have to really be able to justify, you know, any differences in rates and different categories and tiers. You do need to apply them equally across the two sections, if you will, the two systems.
So justifying if we have to go and spend, and I remember Terry's numbers a year or two back, as far as with if we had to bring this up to the standards of the plant that we've got and the Piscataqua River, you know, we could be looking at another $30 or $40 million. We couldn't use that as a justification to charge them more money because we're uploading the capacity level. That wouldn't be a justification.
You'll have to, you have to keep in mind that every, all of those P's entities have been basically supporting and providing your sewer rates or sewer income and revenue for this Pierce Island plant. So it's an interlinked system. And that's the way it was intended when it was set up in terms of how the revenue structure was gonna work. Now that doesn't mean in certain circumstances, sometimes is an appropriate time for contributions. If you've got specific, you know, improvements that are being made from the facility to get to our system. So those are the discussions we're gonna have to have as we, you know, see what the new permit might require. But just recognize there is this agreement out there that requires us to serve and requires some equality across the system.
The municipality agreement, I'm very familiar with it, 200 and something page document. I've read it a couple of times now. And I understand in that municipality as far as water and sewer and water being the bigger portion of that, you know, we provide 100 and some odd million gallons for a golf course. But, you know, as we found out, I think earlier this year, this council with an ask, that we're basically supplying them with the water that they have on site. This isn't something they're using the Portsmouth contributing. And that makes sense. But the justification of going and, I guess, asking all of our users of the city to justify we had $42 million of an increase that's in that sewer treatment plan and the possibility of another 30 and 40, I think we should at least explore the option. So I'm just asking if David, a justification, however it would be, I know we're never gonna be able to change the municipality agreement per se, but as things change with that, I think that sewer thing should be something we should be looking at, and that would just be a rate for that sewer treatment plan only on the users, which would all be commercial, which we all know is the bigger user. That's all. So, Councilor Trace.
Yes, to your comments, Mr. Mayor. Lonza is a producer of recalcitrant nitrogen, and that requires a specific type of treatment other than the normal average nitrogen that we all think of out at Pierce Island. And so my question is to Suzanne, Terry, and Peter. When you were talking, Mr. Mayor, about the $40 million upgrade to Pease, part of that treatment system was to have, I'll use layman terms, you know, a black light or an ultraviolet treatment, because recalcitrant nitrogen requires entirely different commercial treatment, or a switch over from one type to the other. So you do have a company that is requiring a different type of treatment than many other companies. And is that something that we've looked at? Is that something that we take into consideration? Because we are changing the sewer treatment plant out there to be able to better handle recalcitrant nitrogen. And the same thing goes, oddly enough, with the yeast coming from a brewery. That can radically affect your nitrogen and your other figures.
Great. Thank you very much, Councilor Trace. Councilor Kennedy?
You know, the other thing is, I always agree that there's times when maybe we should look at things like this, and maybe this is one of those times, given some of the things that are going on. I do want to remind everyone that one thing we should be clear about is the Pease plant does not service any residents. It only serves Pease, and it's all commercial. So I just want to throw that into the mix. So I realize that they're going to be bringing in some income and whatnot, but As Councillor Trace has said, there is some specification, and as we have growth out there, particularly with one of our plants, you know, what's the extra cost? I believe, as I said, this is going to go on for a little bit. We need to make sure that we can look at everything. And maybe in this time, if things get a little tough, it's time to ask the state to revisit. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? Yes, Peter.
You know, we look forward to having further discussions on this. It's a very important topic, and you know, we'll look at it six ways to Sunday and figure out what's best for the city, and you know, make sure you guys have the information you need to make decisions. So,
great. Thank you very much. Appreciate that,
Peter. Bringing up those questions.
Great. Thank you. Anyone else? All right. With that being said, we have a couple of attendees, so we'll do the public portion. So if there's anyone in the public, we have four attendees. Would anyone like to be able to speak? And I've got Mr. Brighton. Just give you a name and your address, please.
Mark Brighton, 99 Hanover Street. I just have a quick question. Are we still giving away 15 million gallons of water to PDA golf course? I believe that comes out somewhere around $242,000. Just asking. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you. Anyone else? I've got three other people. Anyone else would like to speak? Water just is not that exciting in sewer. So, all right. With that being said, I will close that portion. Does anybody else, staff, anything else before we move on with the rest of our evening? City Manager, any other thoughts?
No, I think we're good. I'd like to thank and commend the staff. They know this stuff backwards and forward, so thank you.
Yes, they do, and I would like to thank all of you as well. I mean, that's, you know, what you guys do best. So we appreciate all of your thoughtfulness and look forward to other discussions to explore the possibility of helping out with some of the revenue issues and stuff that we'll be tackling in the future. So with that being said, I'd like to thank everyone for attending. All right. So I look for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
And we'll do a roll call, please.
Assistant Mayor Splain?
Yes.
Councilor McEachran?
Yes.
Councilor Whalen?
Yes.
Councilor Lazenby?
Yes.
Councilor Kennedy?
Yes.
Councilor Huda?
Yes.
Councilor Chaber?
Yes.
Councilor Trace?
Yes.
Mayor Beckstead?
Yes.
Passes unanimously.
Thank you very much, everybody. Be safe out there.
Thank you.
We'll see you Thursday night.
Yes.